Good morning. Just confirm from your end whether the screen is visible. My screen is visible, which I am sharing now.
Yes, sir. It's visible.
Right. So we will start. Actually, we will not wait much because we have to stop at 11:45. I always need more time for this subject, so try to join as early as possible. How much time I should wait? Only 50 students are joined so far. I think printing students have not joined at all. What is the problem? Okay, we will start. Am I audible? Shall we go ahead?
Yes, sir.
Can you see the numerical statement on screen?
Yes, okay. Sir.
See now. In the last lecture, we had seen this numerical. Okay. We will see now another numerical of similar category. There is one difference, but what difference is there in the new numerical which I will be dealing today? If you see in this numerical, here the all forces are only vertical. The belt tensions are vertical. Self weight is no doubt it's always vertical downward. So weights are vertically downward in this case. All these three forces are vertically downward. And that is why the bending moment was only in one plane. What difference you will notice in today's problem? First of all, this is a problem where figure is not given. Schematic layout is not given. Everything is mentioned in terms of some words. And those words you have to convert into a layout, one diagram, so that you can understand the forces, the positions of pulleys, gears, etc. Okay, so if you notice, what is given? A shaft is supported between two bearings which are 1000 mm apart. Okay, so I'll quickly try to draw one figure with the help of this the statement of the problem. Okay. So let us say this, suppose this is one shaft, okay, and the shaft is supported between two bearings. So what I will do, I will place two symbols here. These are bearing locations, these are bearing locations, and it is mentioned that the distance is 1000 mm apart. Okay, the shaft carries, the second sentence is, the shaft carries two belt pulleys at A and B. So A and B are two locations where two pulleys are mentioned, are placed. Pulley A is of diameter 600 mm, which is mounted at 300 mm to the right of left bearing. So left bearing is this one. This is the left bearing. To the right of left bearing, at a distance of 300 mm, there is one pulley whose diameter is 600 mm. What I do, let us say approximately this is 1000, approximately here it will be a distance of 300 mm, right? So here I am drawing one pulley. This is one pulley. Okay, this pulley is of 600 mm diameter. So immediately I will draw the other view. I will take approximate projections of this pulley from this view, and here somewhere I should draw one pulley, right? So suppose here I am drawing that pulley. Forget about this line. Okay, this is the side view of this pulley. The side view of this shaft, I can show it here. This is the side view of this shaft. And this is the side view of this pulley. The label given is, this is say location A. This is location A. I'll write somewhere here. This is location A, A pulley. And that's why this pulley is A pulley. So I'll say this is a, somewhere I'll write here. This is pulley A. Diameter is 600 mm. So for this pulley, diameter is mean 5. 5 is, it is a convention to show diameter as 5. 5, 600 means diameter of that pulley is 600 mm. This one, the pulley A of diameter 600 mm is mounted at a distance of 300 mm to the right of left bearing and drives a pulley directly below it. Below it means that the tensions, the belt tensions must be shown. The belt tensions must be shown vertically downward, because the pulley is, you know, below, it is mentioned, it is drives a pulley directly below it. So that's why these are two tensions. One tension will be right side, other will be slack side. This is a pulley A, that's why I will be saying this is P1A. P1A stands for tight side tension in pulley A, and this is slack side tension in pulley A, T2A. Then further, maximum tension in the belt, next sentence you see, maximum belt tension in the same pulley is 2.25. This means that P1A is equal to 2.25 kilonewton. Next sentence from this. Pulley B of diameter 400 mm is keyed at 200 mm to the left of right bearing. To the left of right bearing. This is right bearing. To the left of right bearing means here somewhere. Somewhere here. At a location of 200 mm. So approximately I will say distance is say 200 mm. And its diameter is 400. So it is smaller than A pulley, it means, because small diameter of A was 600 mm. So little less dimension, maybe suppose this one. This is a pulley B, right? This is a pulley B. The other view of this I can show somewhere here. This is say that pulley B, right? I'll show this as pulley B, and diameter of this pulley is 400 mm. Okay, right. So this is the meaning of the pulley B of diameter 400 mm is keyed at 200 mm to the left of right bearing and is driven by electric motor placed horizontally to the right. Okay, so how will you implement this sentence? How will you use this sentence in the diagram? And is driven by electric motor placed horizontal to the right. It means that the belt tensions here on this pulley is rightward and horizontally rightward. These are the belt tensions in the pulley B, it means. Okay, now while giving the proper notation, which side is tight side and slack side, I'll give one thumb rule in the all sorts of numericals. If there are only two components, that is two driving components, two pulleys, two gears, one pulley, one gear, this way, one component will always driving component driving to the driving the shaft, and other component is driven, something like this. Because who will give power to it? Electric motor will give power to the shaft through one of the pulleys, and from that the machine will absorb the power. So one pulley will be always, what I am saying, see, I am repeating again, in a two pulley system or one gear one pulley system or two gear system, one component will be always a power transmitting element, and other component will be power absorbing element. Therefore their functions are opposite, and therefore the tensions, rotating tensions, will be opposite to each other. T1A, T2A, if I show this way, if you just say give some, if you pull T1A side, the pulley A will rotate anti-clockwise, and therefore the tension here should be so that it will give some sense of clockwise. So therefore here I must say this is now T1B and T2B. If you still don't understand this, one way is that you can adopt a thumb rule, what I am saying, that one is always the power transmitting, other is always power absorbing. That's why these two tensions must be opposite in sense. T1A, T2A are in place in such a way that it will give a sense of anticlockwise, whereas on the other component, T2B, T1B are to be placed in such a way that they will give the opposite sense. Of course, I don't mean by any way that they are rotating in different directions. That doesn't mean that way. Okay. If you still need some extra explanation of this, I will give some more time. You can stay back after the meeting and you can ask me that question. I will clarify that. Time being, I will just move ahead with this solution, with this thumb rule set. Okay. Now, this is the layout. Okay. Now, this distance is... this distance is how much given it is? It is given as 300 mm, and this distance is given as 200 mm. Okay, something like this. Okay, what I do? I'll use this diagram which is already drawn. I already drawn it. Okay, I use this diagram because little more neatly drawn, this one. Okay, same diagram. Alright. Now, given data you can put like this way to start with, maybe something like this diameter of A pulley so much mm, diameter of B pulley so much mm. Okay, then distance is not to be mentioned here. Maximum belt tension is 2.25. This means that with respect to the notation which I use, this means that P1A is equal to 2.25 kilonewton. This way you can write the data. Diameters is mentioned again. Then angle of flap for both pulleys is 180 degree. You can see now this angle of flap is 180 degree. Friction coefficient between belt and pulley is 0.24. Friction coefficient, generally, we denote it by mu. So therefore, I'll say mu is equal to, how much it is given? Mu is equal to 0.24. It is given as 0.24, something like this. Shaft is made up of steel for which allowable shear stress is 42 megapascal. This is again important. Allowable shear stress. Shear space allowable, shear space permissible is given as 42 megapascal. 42 megapascal means 42 newton per mm square. In one lecture, actually, we have there this. Explain this. 42 newton per mm square. Okay. Now, to start with, first of all, I want your attention should be on this fact that there are so many ways to design the shaft. No? If you refer the earlier lectures, we had seen somewhere design of shaft on the strength basis, design of shaft on as per ASME code, design of shaft on the basis of torsional rigidity, etc. Okay, you have to please understand this. Okay, and if not, you please go to the relevant notes or relevant lecture. Okay. Right. Most of the times, I post these lectures to you on your Google classroom also. Okay. If you think somebody still needs something, you can definitely contact me. I will give you the related lecture link. That is not a problem. So, I will first say that you first try to see ASME code. Always think that whether we can solve it by ASME code or not. One more important thing, that to solve the shaft problem as per the ASME, one thing is must be known to you, first of all, is that SYT and SUT must be known. So just check in the problem whether SYT, SUT of a shaft material is given or not. You will notice that in the statement of the problem, SYT, SUT of the shaft material is not given. Moreover, KB, KT values are also are not given. It means simply that we are not supposed to solve this problem using the ASME code. Right? Now, if it is not to be solved by ASME code, other way is then on the basis of strength. On the basis of strength. What we do actually on the basis of strength, it is not anything different than ASME. Okay? It's not very large difference is not there as per ASME or as per the strength. So that's why what I do, I will not go by ASME because there is no sufficient data to go for ASME because SYT, SUP and KB, KT are not given. So what should be other way that strength basis. In the strength basis, what ultimately two things we have to find out. One is the tau permissible and other is the tau induced. These two things are always required. In the strength basis, whether it is strength basis or whether it is an ASME code, right? Okay. So therefore, on one side, if I bring your attention to this, that I want something tau permissible, shear stress permissible in the shaft material. What is the way to find out shear stress permissible in the shaft material? It is always in general it equal to 0.5 times SYT by factor of safety. Just note again, in the same statement of problem, SYT is not given, factor of safety is not given. But one another thing is given, that permissible shear stress. This means that itself, the answer of this question, answer of this ratio itself is equal to 42 megapascal. That itself is given because permissible shear stress is given, right? So therefore, one thing is very clear, that maximum permissible stress is 42 megapascal, and that is given. Okay. Next thing is what? On one side you should know the permissible stress. On other side you should know the induced stress, induced maximum stress. Okay. Induced maximum stress is given by 16 upon pi d cube under root mb square plus mp square. Just note here, there is no existence of kb and kt in this case, because they play a role, or they come into picture only in the ASME code. Okay, so this is say equation number 2. All game is what? You have to equate these two things, 1 and 2, and you should get an answer. That is very simple philosophy. Only thing that unknown, there are MB and MT are not known, that's why you have to find out these values. And most of the time you have to give to find out these values only. Out of this, I always tell you that MT, that torsional moment, is very easy to find out. That's why you go for torsional moment first. Okay. So I will say here, to find torsional moment, whatever I am doing now, in everything is for to find out the torsional moment MT. Okay, right. What is MT in case of pulley? In case of pulley, MT is equal to difference in belt tensions into radius of that pulley. Therefore, for pulley A, if I write this equation of MT, don't you think that MT should be written as difference in belt tensions on pulley A? It means P1A minus P2A into radius of pulley A is equal to torque transmission by pulley A. To be precise, I can give here torque transmission by pulley A. Okay. Now, whether we can execute this or not, we will see. So, I will see that T1 is unknown, T2 is unknown, MT is unknown, RA is actually known. That radius of pulley A is known. So, this we cannot execute right now. I put it as it is. Let it be equation number 3 there. For any belt rahu, you know, along with this other equation, you can always write down for any belt rahu that is equal to tight side tension divided by slack side tension is equal to e to the power nu theta. This is always written, the theta is in radian. Right? Now, this we can now use because T1A is given as 2.25 kN because it was mentioned here somewhere. Just note here. T1A is 2.25 kN because it was mentioned somewhere. The maximum belt tension in pulley A is 2.25. Okay? Right. So this is how 2.25 kN divided by T2A is, as it is, we'll put, is equal to e to the power mu zeta. Mu is friction coefficient between belt and the pulley material, is given as 0.24. Theta is 180 degree, that's why it is in radian, it is pi. Okay, now from this equation we can find out the value of T2A. Okay, we can find out the value of T2A from this equation. Right? T2A, actually, if I ask you to solve the problem, it will take much time because you will not solve very many of you are not sitting with the calculator, etc. T2A, either I can go ahead with the blank value or I can take it from some source. T2A is 1.058. 1.058, this is kilonewton, no? Just note, this is a kilonewton value. Okay, now, if this is known, you can always put this value into the equation. Which equation? T2A is now
3.
Equation 3. So equation 3, if you put again, it will be unknown. Don't you think that? Okay. Right. T2A and T1A both we will put in equation 3. Somebody mentioned it. So, therefore, I am reserving this space to draw the diagram actually. I think this much space is sufficient. So now I will start writing here. So therefore, equation 3 implies now torque transmission by pulley A is equal to now T1A, which is known value, minus T2A. Earlier I actually said somewhere that T1A is not known, but it is known. Because we are seeing it in equation number three. No, this I can give some label. No need to give any label to this. Okay, we'll go ahead. Okay, so T1A minus T2A into this radius of pulley A. If you now note this, T1A is now known, T2A is now known, RAA is now known. Only precaution you have to take is that you put tension in Newton, distension in Newton. This is in mm. If you put, the answer you will get in Newton mm. Answer you will get in Newton mm. Okay. So this way you get the torque transmission in Newton mm. All right. Torque transmission value actually I'll put, this is somewhere 357.418 × 10³ Nm. So torque transmission we know. So again, equation number two, if you observe, you will see that tau max on the this side, this you equate to permissible. So this is known. It means torque transmission now you know. Okay. Torque transmission now you know. One thing I must clarify here, that here two pulley system is there. That's why torque transmission by pulley A is equal to torque transmission by pulley B. If there is only two pulley system or two gear system, but if there are number of elements are more than two, then you have to find out a maximum torque. Maximum torque. Here, in this case, torque transmission by pulley A is equal to torque transmission by pulley B. That is why that itself is maximum, because there is no other value, right? So therefore, this is now known. Now remaining all exercise is to find out the bending moment. Okay. So therefore now, your next task must be what? Your next task must be to find out the bending moment. Okay, and that too a maximum moment. This we always find out a maximum moment. What we should know to find maximum moment? First of all, we should know all the forces and the reactions. Okay, so now therefore I again draw one diagram here. This is a line diagram, say. Somewhere here there was A point, somewhere here there was B point, and I label another point here. This is say C point, and this is suppose some D point. Okay. Now, if we just think about pulley A, we have seen that on pulley A, there were two forces. One was T1A, other was T2A in the form of belt tensions. And both these tensions or both these forces are vertically downward. So therefore, if I ask you the question that which forces are acting on pulley A here, your answer should be T1A plus T2A. Net effect is T1A plus T2A should be acting on A, and that is vertically downward. So therefore, I should write here, this is a force. This is now T1A plus, I don't think I can complete the problem because it will take a lot of time. But what I do, I will not play with the numbers. I'll explain the procedure. Please understand that you have to solve it at your home. Okay. I have given this problem already. These three problems I have given to you on your unofficial WhatsApp group. I sent to some students. Okay, you have to solve those problems. You can always, whether it is mandatory or not, whether it is assignment is given to you or not, you can always submit those to me through WhatsApp, through mail. Okay, through WhatsApp preferably, or through Google Classroom. I can definitely go through it and help you if there is any mistake. Okay, so this is T1A plus T2A. Now, if I ask you that what is the force acting on point B, your answer should be there are two forces acting. One is T1B. Something is wrong here. This is T1A, and other is T2A. Okay. So now coming to back to this point B. Point B means pulley B. On pulley B there is again belt tensions, but belt tensions are horizontal. Therefore, if I ask you to draw only vertical force diagram, then there will not be any force acting on point B. Just remember, just note, I am just talking about all forces in vertical direction. Whether it is upward or direct, upward or downward doesn't matter, but all forces in vertical directions. There is no force on B acting vertically downward because there are belt tensions, and those belt tensions on pulley B are horizontally rightward, not up tension, upward or downward. That's why there is no force acting on B as far as vertical force diagram is concerned. You have to remember this, you have to understand this. Therefore, there is only one force. And now support is at C and D. I will say that if the support is at C and D, here I should write you some direction. Here, this is reaction at C, but because of vertical force. Similarly, at D location, this is reaction at C because of vertical forces only. Right? This means that this is not an entire reaction. This is a part of reaction. Vertical, just like you have any force and you resolve into two components, vertical force and horizontal force. Similarly, if there is a complete reaction and you are resolving into two components, one is vertical component of the reaction, other is the horizontal component of the reaction. Vertical component of the reaction is corresponding to only vertical forces, and horizontal force, horizontal reaction will be in response to horizontal forces. Okay, why we are doing this all, you'll come to know in just in a couple of minutes. So what we do now, if this is a loading diagram, next task is to find out the forces, because forces must be known to find out the bending moment. So forces must be known means to find out the reaction. What you do to find reaction? Summation of moment at C is equal to zero. If we apply this equation to this diagram, what you will get? You will get one equation. Now I will not put number because it will not. I will not finish it in 45 minutes. Summation of moment at C is equal to zero. What will be your answer? What will be your equation? Will be equal to T1A plus T2A, this is combined one number because we know both the numbers, into distance. The distance, if you just remember, the distance was 300 into 300. Okay, now this is giving a clockwise moment, so I'll say clockwise moment is positive. This is my convention. You can have a convention otherwise also, but this is my convention. I'm using this convention that clockwise moment is positive for me, and therefore minus RCV into 1000, the complete length was 1000, is equal to 0. You can just note T1A, T2B are known. From this, what you get? You get the value of RCV. RCV in this case will be positive definitely. Looking into the directions of the applied forces, I am very sure RCV will be positive. Okay, so this much Newton of RCV. Are here something wrong? Huh? This is something wrong. This notation is wrong. This is actually RDV. This is RDV, and this point is RD. Okay, reaction at RDV. Okay, I am correcting myself. So this is RDV. RCV into T1A plus T2A into 300 minus RDV into 1000. That's why this will be RDV.
Sir, it is T1A plus T2A, na?
Are, oh yes, right, please correct my correct, no? Please correct me. This is all about the pulley A. Okay, T1A plus T2A, right? So you get the RDV. Okay, so we'll not put numbers. Now next is what? To find out the RCV, what you do? Summation of
FI,
right? FI is equal to zero. What, by this way you can find out, let us say, suppose upward forces are positive for me. So RCV minus this P1A plus P2A combined and plus RDV is equal to zero. From this equation, now you can find out the remaining force, that is now RCV. Okay. So what is point, important point is that we found out all the reactions. Well, so you know reactions, next step is what? To find the bending moment. Okay. So bending moment, to find the bending moment. So bending moment, say MB. Now bending moment, now I will use the word vertical bending moment here because only vertical forces are considered. That is why I will say vertical bending moment only, because I am considering only vertical forces. So vertical bending moment at C is equal to zero, at A is equal to, it will be equal to just
RCV into distance.
Very good. This is equal to RCV into 300. Now this is a bending moment. That's why it's so hugging or sagging. You have to take a note with this, with respect to this this force. Because of this force at this point, if you just hold this A, just hold A and push C part with the in the direction of RCV, you get something like this. This is a sagging bending moment. This is a sag. Sagging is considered positive. As per convention, you can have the reverse convention also. So this is a positive moment. Whatever number you RCV is known, whatever number you get, this is a bending moment at A. Okay. This will be Newton mm. Okay. Now, at C, bending moment at C, A and at D. Bending moment at D again equal to zero. Okay. But again, one thing is important that you have to find at B also. Why? Because it's a critical point. Okay. At B also you have to find out. How to find at B? It will be equal to, it will be equal to again, correct, RDV into distance is 200. Whatever number you get, this is Newton mm. And now if you plot these numbers, you have to now plot these numbers here. So I again draw the line diagram just below the corresponding points. This is again a D for me. This is again a B for me. This is a A for me. And this is a C point. Now, both are positive. Actually, I should below I'll draw it. This is C. This is A. Somewhere this is B and this is B. Okay. So at A, somewhere here, maximum will be at A actually. Okay. If you just observe the numbers, and then you have to join by straight line because there is no force from C to A. Similarly, here also you have to join by straight line, straight line. But of course, this number you must know, even though you join by straight line, because there is no force between A to D. This number still you have to find out, and that we found out at here, at B. We found out this at B. Okay. This is a bending moment diagram. This is a bending moment diagram. Now to give a precise name, I will say this is a vertical bending moment diagram, VBMD, vertical bending moment diagram. Now same exercise you have to do for horizontal forces. Now horizontal forces, again what I do, I will just project this same point B, A and C. Now if I ask you, what is the horizontal force acting at A? Answer should be, there is no force acting at A. Horizontal force I am saying, yeah? There is no horizontal force acting at A. Horizontal force acting at B is there, right? So B is there. Okay. Now, what is the value of this? Now I am drawing this. You will be confused now a little bit, and I will clarify your confusion. I am saying that this is equal to P1B plus t2b. Okay, t1b plus t2b. Now, why on one side I am saying that these are horizontal forces, and on the diagonal actually I am showing it vertical. So that is only a part of convention. Like, no, this way. Suppose if you see the in engineering drawing somewhere, if suppose this is one line, right, and you show one line this as a side top view and this as a front view, okay, and then what you do, you rotate, this is actually horizontal on horizontal plane, but you rotate it this way and you make it in line with this, something like this you get, and then you say this is vertical plane, this is a horizontal plane, right? So actually something like this is happening. This is actually a horizontal force, but I am showing in a top view. So you just consider that this T1B to T2B actually is a horizontal force, but I am showing it in a top view. That's why I see it as a, I see it as a vertical, nothing else. There's only convention, because how do I show it horizontal force here then? Okay. So again, if this is not clear, I can give you some time if you require, but not at this moment because I have to finish it. Okay. Now here, again, this must be what? This must be RD because of horizontal force. And this must be because of RC because of horizontal force. So this is a loading diagram. Now precisely I should write here what, to label it, I should say this is a horizontal force diagram. This is a horizontal force diagram. Now, to find reactions, all forces must be known. To find, in fact, to find bending moment further, all forces must be known. We'll just check whether T1B, T2B are known or not. So I think that we have not found out T1B, T2B. Okay. So what we'll do? We'll first find out this T1B and T2B. Okay. How to find T1B, T2B? On a similar lines, the way we did in for pulley A. So for pulley B, you can write again these two equations. One equation is what? One equation is T1B. One equation is T1B divided by T2B is equal to e to the power mu theta. Mu is same for the both pulleys. Theta is pi radian. That's why this number is known. T1B upon T2B. So what do you get from this? You get from this, since T1B, T2B both are unknown at this moment, I'll say that T1B divided by T2B is equal to some number. This is my equation number, say 5. Okay. Another equation which always we write for pulley is what? Is what? For pulley B, I'll say T1B minus T2B into radius of the pulley B is equal to torque transmission by pulley B. Just note here, torque transmission by pulley B and torque transmission by pulley A is same, because one is power transmitting, other is power absorbing. Same amount of power is transferred, same amount of power is delivered. Okay, considering there is no loss. This is the ideal problem. This is the ideal situation. Considering there is no loss. So therefore, you just think that this is known. This is equal to torque transmission by A, which is already known. And now RB is also known. So what do you get here? You get T1B minus T2B, again some number. This is equation number 6. You can solve simultaneously equation number 5 and equation number 6, because both contains T1B, T2B. You can get the value of T1B and T2B. Both values we get. Once we get both values of T1B, T2B, what you do? You put T1B, T2B here, and now you have to find reactions. The similar way what we did for pulley A, you have to find out reactions at RCH and reaction RDH. Okay. Now consider that those reactions are now known. Okay. Let us say by some way earlier, the way which you earlier, RCH and RDH are now known values. If these are known values, don't you think that you can find out the bending moment corresponding to the this diagram now? It will be horizontal bending moment at C, extreme left. Horizontal bending moment at A. Horizontal bending moment at B. And horizontal bending moment at D. This is equal to 0. Two extremes, this is equal to 0. This is equal to, with respect to this diagram, horizontal bending moment at A will be equal to RCV into C, RCH into 300. RCH into 300. So this is equal to, RCH into 300. Now whether it is positive or negative, who will define it? Just see, with respect to this A position, hold A and force and push RCH in the direction of RCH. Push the point C in the direction of RCH. What do you get? You will get a sagging moment again. So this is a positive quantity. Similarly, at B, you can see this is equal to now RDH into 200. Again, you notice that RCH, RDH, out of these two, some will be maximum, and that you have to plot it here. What you will plot? I will plot this way. Correction I will do. This is straight line, just note that this is straight line. Okay, this way. Right? This point, this you can find out. This view. That is nothing but our body moment at A. Now, to label it, it will be horizontal bending moment diagram. Okay? So now, ultimately, you have got four values. See, vertical bending moment at C and D, horizontal bending moment at C and D, all are zero. Therefore, if I think about maximum or resultant, the way you do in forces, one force vertical, other force horizontal, what you do? You do it, you find reaction by considering summation of these forces, squares of this, under root. Similarly, if I want to find out resultant bending moment at C, will be zero because both are zero. Both means horizontal, vertical, both bending moments at C, zero. Similarly, at D, again zero. At A, it will be equal to under root bending moment, I'll say it this way, I'll write in terms of notation, vertical bending moment at A square, this number you know, and horizontal bending moment at A square, this also number you know. This is something like Fy square, Fx square, right? This is horizontal, this is vertical. Both numbers are now known for A. From this you can find out resultant bending moment at A. Similarly, I can find out, please give me 2-3 more minutes, don't leave, resultant bending moment at B is equal to vertical bending moment at B, this number you know, square, plus horizontal bending moment at B square, this also square, this is a number also you know. Put these numbers and get the answer. This will be what? This will be resultant bending moment at B. Right? Now compare this number. This is say some 7 equation. This is suppose 8. Compare this 7 and 8. Out of these two, peak maximum. And that maximum value is to be put into equation number 2, which was till now unknown. And this way, if you now see the equation number 2, D is only unknown. You can find out the value of D. Right? this way you have to finish. I know that within 1 hour I cannot explain it completely, this all thing. By writing data, numbers and explanation, all thing cannot be done in 1 hour, 45 minutes. That's why please forgive me, I'm going fast today. But again, I repeat that you only have to exercise this. I have given you 3 problems. You try, please try to solve this problem. Ask any difficulty. Do some calculations on your own, with your own calculators, and this will only help you in the calculation process. Procedure I can tell you 10 times. That's not a problem. But I cannot solve problem all. But it will take a lot of time, and then we cannot end up with the large number of problems. Right. So today we will stop here. Immediately I'll give a link here. What would be the attendance? Please give the link. Please give the attendance. Please give the feedback. What you are getting, what you are not getting, what else you need from my side, etc. You can always give some remarks. Okay. So timing is almost, because timing is from 11:45. You may have lectures at 12, so you may get some time, 10 minutes time. Those who have any question, they can stay back, they can ask the question. Those who are done with the attendance and no question further, no doubt further, they can leave. I am trying my best. It is now your part to understand and to practice. Ask in a doubt. If you solve 3-4 problems on the start, then entire problems are almost in the similar lines you will get.